session, the live interview. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our interviewer today, Dr. Ramakant Deshpande, who is a leading cancer surgeon, well known in the country and also internationally. He is also known for his pioneering work in the field of thoracoscopic surgery. He established the Department of Robotic Surgery at the Asian Cancer Institute in Mumbai. He is a member of several professional organizations in his field and is the past president of the Indian Society of Oncology. He is a postgraduate teacher and examiner in oncology and has over 60 publications to his credit in peer-reviewed national and international scientific journals. He was honored with the Padma Shri in 2014 for his contributions in the field of medicine. He is currently the executive chairman at Asian Institute of Oncology and the director of the charity organization Asian Cancer Foundation in Mumbai. I would now hand over the reins to our program director, Dr. Ameshwara. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Kashish. And it is nothing less than an honor that we have Dr. Deshpande sir here with us. I think anybody in the field of oncology does not need introduction to Dr. Deshpande. He is completely synonymous with thoracic surgical oncology. And I know, at least in Mumbai, people amongst each other talk that teri surgery Deshpande sir ne kiya na, tu chinta mat kar, tu theek rahega. That is the level of confidence I think he has inspired through his hard work. In fact, the last patient who visited Delhi, told me ke sir mera dressing to Deshpande sir karte the, aapki dressing yahan pe nurse kyun kar rahi hai. That was, you know, the commitment what we see in him. Before we start interacting with him, I wanted to request one of his close old friend and colleague, Dr. Purvish Parikh sir, to say something about sir. And my sir main question to you, since I love to ask questions, how would a medical oncologist view a surgical oncologist like Dr. Deshpande, especially in the field of lung cancer? Sir, over to you.
Thank you very much, Amish, for this opportunity. And everybody knows, like you said, that Raman is a very accomplished thoracic onco surgeon. And in addition to that, he is an innovator, he is a visionary. And that is how he is leading all the progress that Asian Cancer Institute has made so far. But I would like to share today an anecdote of how things could have been totally different if his career path would have changed for one small incident. So Dr. Raman is 2 years older to me. He was born in Dharwad in Karnataka. He graduated from Karnataka Medical College. And then he came to Mumbai. And he was applying for the post of a general surgeon at the municipal hospital. Okay. So with the name of Raman Deshpande, the clerk at the window was very happy to give him the application form. And suddenly he found out that he is not a Maharashtrian, he is from Karnataka. Immediately the clerk snatched back the application from Raman Deshpande. And that is the reason why instead of going and becoming a general surgeon, he came to Tata Hospital and became a thoracic surgeon. So this is, you know, a little story of how his career path has been, driven towards oncology. And it is a proud privilege for me as a medical oncologist to know him as an international figure who is respected all over the world. Back to you, Amish.
Thank you so much, sir. It's an our honor. I think we lucked out when his form was snatched. Yes. This is an amazing. Sir, thank you so much on this platform. And we thank you again for taking out your time. You are there ever since we started this webinar. And I really, really feel honored about that. So my first question, which I would like you to answer is, see, anything what, sir, you say in the field of lung cancer or anything I told you Sudeep says in the field of breast cancer, people listen to you people. If I have to ask you the three revolutionary changes which has happened in the field of surgery in lung cancer in last 30 or 38 years of your career, how would you, what would you name them?
Thank you, Amish. Just to start with, and I, first you asked me as how does a surgical oncologist view his association with a medical oncologist. It's like, you know, there is a saying in a Marwadi that kana kana bane nahi, kana bina sahi nahi, you know, which means that I can't get along well with you and I can't fight with you. It's like that. So I think these two are three disciplines are so strongly intertwined that, you know, they actually complement each other. There is basically no competition between radiation oncology, surgical oncology, or medical oncology, though the practitioners of these actually tend to compete with each other quite a lot. When we start putting our heads together, that's when actually the real progress comes. You know, I started my career in 1982. If I visit that back again, I can probably see 70 as a inner play school or something like that. That was when I started my career at Kidwai Cancer Center. Those were the days where surgeons actually ruled the roost. Thoracic oncology was absolutely the everything that the surgeon actually did was the only thing which actually went into offering any cure or a long-term kind of a palliation and all that. I remember in 1985, that time there was a UICC consultant called Dr. Martin Tattersall, who was a medical oncologist who had chosen to go into public health. And there was a big VIP lady who had a CA lung. Primary lesion was fairly small and she had a pleural effusion. So I went with him for a visit and it was obviously a stage four by that definition those days in 1985. And all that he told that husband of the lady who could have done anything, he could have spent any amount of money, that go home and be lucky. That's it. Spend as much time with your wife as much as possible. You know, now I don't have to really tell the medical oncologists that things are totally, totally different today. That lady probably would be living for several decades if not completely cured, if she shows a mutation. So things have changed quite a lot. But as a surgeon, I can tell you what are the things which have actually made a lot of difference. You know, from this position of a single strength, actually the real first addition came was in 1995 when the meta-analysis of chemotherapy in advanced cancer lung was published in the BMJ, which showed that in 9,387 patients comprising of 52 trials, there was a 13% reduction in death and a 5% benefit in survival. That was the first time when the surgeons were told that, yes, there can be a meaningful improvement in survival with chemotherapy. All right. Now, this is not the era of 1995 was not the era of the very evolved targeted therapy or immunotherapy or anything. These were all very basic drugs. But even with these stones and javelins and all that, the medical oncologists were making a difference. You know, so that is the first thing which as a surgeon from the point of surgical field that we could see. And then came all the field of preoperative chemotherapy, postoperative chemotherapy. This is a drug, that is a drug. So that was the first publication which made a little difference. Same year, actually, in 1995, there was another publication from Memorial Sloan Kettering in Annals of Thoracic Surgery, which showed, that was a Bob Ginsburg publication, which compared a segmental resection versus wedge resection of cancer lung to offer the cure. The numbers were not very large like the meta-analysis of the BMJ. They were only in the mid-200s. But, you know, when they compared that a non-anatomical segmental resection vis-a-vis an anatomical lobectomy was compared, the non-anatomical resection actually increased the mortality rate by double as much and caused local recurrences in three times as many patients. In fact, the results were so stark that in the interim analysis after 2.5 years, the lung cancer study group results showed that they must abandon the trial, and this trial was abandoned halfway through. And that is how lobectomy became a very standard kind of a treatment in case of early lung cancer. You know, this is how things have actually evolved. Earlier, it used to be, okay, you can do a lobectomy, you can do a pneumonectomy, and all so on and so forth. So these are all the landmark kind of developments. After that, things continued, everything continued like that. Then in medical oncology in 2009 came the targeted therapy announcement of the EGFR mutations, etc. Though it It was just a progression of what happened in 1995, the meta-analysis that went through a different side. It is very important for the medical oncology, but it didn't really make so much difference for the surgeons, except probably an application of the same thing, the targeted therapy, hopefully over a period of time for use as neoadjuvant therapy, if at all. We still are awaiting those results. It has not yet happened. The next surgical publication, the third one, was, so as I mentioned, 1995-1, 1995-2. The third one is a meta-analysis of robotic surgery versus open surgery in cancer lung in an international journal of clinical and experimental medicine. So what was compared was a RATS, that's a robotic thoracotomy for resection of lung surgery, for lung cancer, vis-a-vis the thoracotomy, open thoracotomy. And these were about 2,433 patients. And it showed that if you use robotic surgery, it can have almost a 14% benefit in reducing the morbidity and even mortality, with while keeping the survival almost the same. So if the surgeon is more comfortable, then probably your delivery of the healthcare is going to be better. So these three things made a lot of difference in the field of surgery. Now, the application, as you see, is in different fields. The first one, which said that yes, a combined modality treatment is probably better than only one modality. That's in 1995. The second one showed that understanding the biology of the tumor is extremely important, because then what happened is this limited resection versus radical resection went ahead, and then the Japanese data started coming in. And then eventually they found that if the tumor is small and if you're going to do a limited resection like segmental resection, the normal area that you're going to take out around the tumor, the diameter of that area has to be at least equal or more than the diameter of the tumor. This is very important. So you know now that yes, if you are going to do a conservative surgery, this is at least what you're going to see. So if you as a medical oncologist receive a reference of a patient who has undergone a conservative resection, all that you need to do is just pick up that pathology report, identify what is the normal tissue around that particular tumor. That is, the cut margin is, suppose there's a tumor of 2 centimeters. So if the person, if the pathology report says that the cut margin is say 5 millimeters away, you can pick up a phone and tell your surgeon that, sir, this is not an adequate resection. So this is how you are going to interpret, which means that your approach towards treatment for that patient is going to be more aggressive as compared to somebody who has undergone a radical resection. So these are the very, very important things. Now, these three publications are very important in case of surgical line. Now, there are other publications also.
Sir, you have said three. Let's move on to a few more questions.
Yeah, sure.
You have answered partly the second question. So right. I would combine the second and the third question together for the want of time.
Right.
My second question was about the biological behavior. You talked about the targeted therapy. We talked about immunotherapy.
Right.
We talked about mutation positive.
Yes.
Do these biology, different biology, change your surgical approach when you are resecting a tumor? And in the same field, you can answer, is there an impact of neoadjuvant chemotherapy?
Yes.
No. On the surgical field? Yes. We know about the liver, we know about the colon a lot. A lot has been studied. But yes. I would like to know about the lung cancer.
Correct. Yes, neoadjuvant chemotherapy. If you really analyze why we use neoadjuvant therapy, I don't really need to discuss it in front of such a august audience. Now, but what happens is it does causes a lot of changes. It causes a lot of inflammation in the tumor. So initially, it may cause a little increased vascularity, then fibrosis, then consolidation of the tumor. But when you operate these patients who have undergone neoadjuvant chemotherapy, there are changes because of the chemotherapy in the organs of that particular patients. So if there is somebody who has got a severe comorbidity, suppose a cardiac patient, cardiac compromised patient, and if he has received Taxol, obviously that ejection fraction may be much less. So these patients actually become a little high risk patients as far as this is concerned. Okay, that is one. while technical execution of the surgery is concerned, does it really make much of a difference? Yes, the blood loss is definitely a little higher, but the planes are definitely a little more better than what they would have been earlier. The tissue actually separate, the tumor tissue can separate from something which is fairly adherent. It can actually separate from the tumor. This becomes very important as far as possible when you are looking at an adhesion to an aortic wall or to a spine or something like that. So neoadjuvant chemotherapy does help, but it also causes a little bit of problem. Now, does this have a material difference as far as the morbidity and mortality is concerned? Morbidity may be a little more. These patients are like more likely to need respiratory support. Mortality, I don't think it makes that kind of a difference. So I think that's perfectly okay. Now, when you are saying neoadjuvant therapy, when do you give it and when do you actually stop it? Generally, you would give neoadjuvant therapy when the disease is more of a loco-regional type, not only a very small disease which can be taken out and easily kind of cured. So it's more of a loco-regional thing. But then you don't really complete the entire lot. Suppose if you have decided that, yes, this patient should receive, say, 6 cycles, then by and large, unlike in breast cancer, we would prefer that it should be stopped halfway, reassessed, and if adequate reduction in size of the tumor is done, then we go ahead with the surgery and then follow up with further therapy later. So it's important because this is very relevant now for us because in case of COVID, we had patients who have not been able to undergo surgery. So they have responded up to 3. I mean, we have taken the response after 3 cycles. We find that this becomes smaller. And surprisingly enough, over a period of next 3 cycles, the disease has actually grown. And I had one patient who actually became inoperable during that particular time. It's a biological selection. Probably this patient would not have done well in any case. But normally we would say that neoadjuvant chemotherapy reviews are extremely important.
Thank you so much, sir. So I'm very tempted to ask one question. Intraoperatively, the way we have the biology report with us, yeah, it says PD-L1 80%. And based on just that one line, the medical oncologist can go on and on, on and on. All the panel discussion is on PD-L1 80%.
Yeah.
Intraoperative, sir, can you identify this patient is going to do well or this patient is not going to do well based on certain things? And my last question, because you know we are short of time, sir, is that do you think the role of surgeon in future is going to be more and more defined? I don't want to use the word less and less. That's why I'm using the word more and more defined. You can answer that, sir.
No, one thing is, does the positivity of either a mutation or PD-L1, can the surgeon really make it out? It's very difficult, I must say that, you know. Only thing is, if I have that kind of a result available in advance, then probably, you know, I can keep that thing at the back of my mind rather than doing a potentially hazardous kind of a resection for that particular patient, realizing that, no, there is something which I can fall back upon. But as a surgeon, I am called for doing a curative resection. So today, I mean, for example, what did Purvesh say? That we are not sure whether we are offering curative kind of a therapy with a targeted or a immunological therapy. So though they may not be common, then you, in your mind, you need to actually evaluate the relative benefit as, am I going to do more damage by extending my resection, or should I fall back upon something which is potentially very good but may not be curative? It doesn't really matter. At least the patient will win the battle. He may lose the war, but at least he will win the battle. Now, coming back to the how is the role of, I mean, it was very nice of you, but what you asked me is surgery still relevant? Yes, surgery will remain relevant for some time. Is the science of surgery for offering an R0 resection still very relevant? I think there is enough data. If you start analyzing, actually what happens is, and when we take out entire disease, which is visible, that is entire microscopic clearance, it's called an R0 resection. So does an R0 resection patient do better than an R1 and R2 resection, which R2 is grossly, there is disease. You know, today in any solid tumors, except in embryological tumors, like testicular tumor or mediastinal germ cell tumor, there is no role for leaving back disease. You know, you don't take any prisoners there. because then you are not doing any good. There are virtually no survivals after 18 months if you are going to see disease at the end of the surgery. So yes, the art and science and the technique of surgery is extremely important. And this is where actually the newer methods like robotics or minimally invasive surgery or a newly learning surgeon actually fails, that he or she may not really realize that this is extremely important to achieve an R0 resection. If you realize all the preoperative investigations are aimed to find out whether I can give postoperative R0 resection or not. So I'll tell you, the art and science and the technique of surgery will remain relevant long as the oncology and surgeon both live.
Thank you, sir. And that's why, sir, I said in the beginning, patients, they talk to each other. आपका सर्जरी देशपांडे सर ने किया है ना, चिंता नहीं, आप ठीक रहोगे करके. एंड दैट इज ट्रू बिकॉज वी हैव ऑनेस्टली वी ऑल बिलीव दैट सर्जरी एस्पेशली इन सॉलिड ट्यूमर्स इंक्लूडिंग लंग कैंसर इज गोइंग टू स्टे फॉर डिकेड्स टू कम. आई डोंट थिंक दैट इट विल चेंज द वे वी आर स्टिल प्रैक्टिसिंग. येस, रिफाइनमेंट्स ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी वुड हैपन. विद दैट आई थैंक यू सो मच सर फॉर टेकिंग आउट योर टाइम एंड गिविंग योर वैल्यूएबल इनपुट्स. थैंक यू सो मच सर.
Thank you very much, Amish. Thank you. It's been a pleasure. And I've been watching the HOPE webinars and they've been wonderful. Really
additive. Thank you so much, sir. I must tell, with this, I must tell all the people who are here, Deshpande sir, in spite of his busy schedule, he went through PCP1 and PCP2 live interviews. He saw them on YouTube and he tried to understand what is happening and what is required of him. I really hats off to you, sir, for taking out that much time and understanding how we go about it. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. With